And good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Family Arena. The theme tonight is new. New league, new rules, new players. 10 of them are new, and we're going to see tonight the St. Louis Ambush against the Milwaukee Wave. Hello again, everybody. I'm Bill McDermott. Alongside is Ty Keel. And Ty, I think what Daryl Durand clearly wants to improve on is that 4-16 record from last year.
Well, as an expansion team, yep. It was a tough year. Too many players injured, critical players like a Jeff DeMaria, weren't able to contribute. We've got a little bit more of a foundation going into this particular season. You have Odane Sinclair, the rookie of the year last year, perhaps a bit healthier than he was last year as well. He could be a dominant attacking force as well. But a lot of new things, a lot of history on indoor soccer here in St. Louis too.
We watched the open today at the Family Arena just moments ago. It depicted that same history that Ty was talking about, St. Louis Steamers, the St. Louis Ambush, the St. Louis Storm. So the pedigree of indoor soccer is here. This guy used to wear number 10 for the Steamers in the real halcyon era. We're moments away from the second year as the Ambush play at the Family Arena. I think, Ty, I asked Daryl Durand, you would know best, having still played indoor occasionally, still outdoor. Is there any one key to be successful in indoor soccer?
Well, I think one of the keys would be to always keep fresh legs on the field because you can change on the fly. There's no question. There's no resting on the field. You should see a high pace and intensity on every shift for every player. And I think big motivation for the Ambush tonight. They lost 6 times to the Milwaukee Wave last season. So payback is in the air.
Positively. And if you want to be successful in this Central Division, you're going to have to play this Milwaukee Wave team on a regular basis, and you have to be successful, in particular here at home. So just moments away from the kickoff as your St. Louis Ambush begin their second season here at the Family Arena against the visiting Milwaukee Wave. Again, I'm Bill McDermott, Ty Keel. We'll be with you many times this year on the Gateway Television Network. We're underway now. Action begins here at the Family Arena. The Milwaukee Wave, all white with the yellow. As a matter of fact, the electric fluorescent yellow socks. Your home side, St. Louis Ambush in the all-teal black socks. It's Chan Vandergrift defending. Save right away from Greg Crook. Greg Crook played his intercollegiate soccer at SIU Ebersville. Very good goalkeeper, Daryl Durand tells me. Sure on his line, good with his feet. That's key, Ty. You got to be good with your feet in indoor soccer.
And Greg Crook going to be under pressure here. You can see Milwaukee, they're a more established team.
They're a more established team. They're content to keep the ball. They're very, very patient. I heard them talking prior to the game. Let's just keep the ball and make them chase. This is Jonathan Greenfield with the ball at his feet. Notice how they just knock it around, make the other team chase, even though the other team is playing at home.
Well, the Ambush goalkeeper, Greg Crook, is going to have a really big match. Mm-hmm.
So he'll keep them in the game, if it be at all possible. And I know what the Ambush wants to do. Double on players occasionally, chase back occasionally, like Corey Adamson's doing right there. This is Odane Sinclair, the rookie of the year last year in the indoor soccer. This is a new league this year, as I had talked about. This is the MASL, Major Arena Soccer League. Now, Milwaukee Wave in possession. Again, they mentioned they're wearing all white uniforms, yellow socks. The teal uniforms worn by your St. Louis Ambush. No score, we're just underway here at the Family Arena. This is Stefan Saint-Louis back to defend for your St. Louis Ambush. Defending and keeping it nicely in his own backfield, tries to clear, does just that. The Ambush now with some rare possession, at least at the very outset here. Number 81, another new player, Blake Gardell. This is Chad Vandegrift back for his goalkeeper. This is Greg Crook. We just talked about his abilities. Long ball flatted out of the deep end of the St. Louis Ambush. Looking for the forwards. This is Elvir Kafedjic. The Bosnian, a welcome player back tie for the St. Louis Ambush.
Yeah, he spent most of the season last year injured, and he's a very confident player on the dribble in tight spaces.
They look forward to him being back into the game, into the starting 11, into the starting lineup, I should say. I talked to him prior to the game. He said, you know what, it's just it's still a work in progress, but I'm getting much healthier. You can see right away that he's comfortable on the dribble. This is Corey Adamson. Scored a hat trick earlier this year in an exhibition game. Always anxious to get forward and get into the attack is Addison. This is Manny Forbes with the shot at the near post. Just wide of that near post and high. Manny Forbes, he's a real runner, Daryl Durand tells me. He will run after anything, chases everything.
Yeah, Forbes, quick, dangerous. Adamson impressed me on his shot that just missed the target because that ball was dipping. I mean, he got all of it. Number 4, Adamson, Corey Adamson.
Now the Milwaukee Wave, a possession long ball out of their own backfield, looking for Marcelo Fontana, who comes in tonight's game at 41. That's right, folks, 41 years of age. Jonathan Greenfield to his right back partner. That's number 23, Victor Quiroz. Ambush attempting to defend. They can't quite do so. Milwaukee keeps it nicely. Jonathan Greenfield at the left back position. Forbes defending. We're in that first period. There's four 15-minute periods, 11:52 remaining in this, the first period. Still no score. Your Ambush beginning their second season of play here at St. Louis St. Charles Family Arena. Wave still in possession. Push. Foul was set up against number 16. That is Anthony Arrico for the Wave. Free kick for the Ambush deep in their own half. Still tied. The ball cannot be flighted over three lines. Still the same rule there, isn't it?
Yeah, otherwise it would start looking like the English First Division back in the 70s.
Back in the day, yeah.
In the late 60s, early 70s.
Yeah, fortunately that's changed for the better. This is Greg Crook, the Ambush goalkeeper, out of his own backfield, looking for Corey Adamson. Breaks loose for O'Dane Sinclair on a dribble. Sinclair, ooh, Adams almost ran onto that ball. Here is Sinclair across the face. Yes! And he continues true to form. Corey Adamson, he got the first goal last year for the Ambush. He does much the same now.
Corey Adamson, a well-timed run towards that near post as O'Dane Sinclair was off to the right side using the plexiglass. There's Sinclair bodying a few people off. Pops out to him. He knows what to do. Off the boards. Adamson well positioned, timing his run. But Sinclair knew what he wanted. As soon as he was able to seize possession, he wanted to get that ball off the boards, straight out in front.
Perfect ball from Sinclair off the near post boards to the feet of Corey Adamson. Had 8 goals, 4 assists last year. As I mentioned, he got the first goal last year for the Ambush, and he got the last goal, and it continues true to form. Number 4, Cordy Amson, puts the Ambush on top by a score of 1-0, 11 minutes remaining in this, the first quarter. 4:15s. We're at the St. Charles Family Arena. I'm Bill McDermott, alongside is Ty Keough. St. Louis Ambush Soccer on this, the Gateway Television Network. There is Daryl Duran, the man, the myth, the legend, as Brian Roth called him when he introduced him on the PA in his 13th season coaching. Think he could still play, Ty?
I know he can. He plays on my over 50 Sunday morning team.
Free kick at the top of the arc, and yes, it's there. No question whatsoever by that. Luan Salas Oliveira prefers to be called LSO. When he can strike a ball like that, we'll just leave you say whatever you like. LSO with the first, and that's an equalizer for the Milwaukee Wave.
That ball was an absolute flaming rocket just inside the post. Looked like Greg Crook never saw it. He may have been a little bit unsighted by the wall in front of him.
I think he was unsighted, Ty.
But what a quality shot.
Struck superbly by LSO, Luan Salas Oliveira. 1-1, St. Louis Ambush visiting Milwaukee Wave. Out of their own backfield now comes the St. Louis Ambush. Blake Ordell couldn't quite keep control. Picking up is J.C. Banks for the Milwaukee Wave. He's fouled in the process. Free kick for the Wave. Ordell tries to clear, looking for Sinclair. Coming forward is J.C. Banks. Now for Marcio Lete. This guy is very troublesome. Likes to play balls in on the ground, inside the penalty area, like that right there. Good reaction by Greg Crook.
Yeah, he saw the flick and was able to read it. Quick off his line was Crook.
Chad Vandergriff, he tried to find Sinclair. Milwaukee Wave comes forward again. This time it's Pablo. Wave still in possession. It's Pablo, top of the arc.
It was a handball.
It is indeed a handball inside the penalty area. Free kick for the Milwaukee Wave at the tip of the penalty area arc. And handball inside the penalty area. This is Marcio Lete.
The ball being a little more carefully placed, I would think, after paying the price on the last situation, just like this. This looks like it'll be...
Same play.
Yeah. Right foot.
Marcio Lete deflects wide, goes off the near post boards. Struck again by Ian Bennett. Nicely done by the Wave to keep possession. Back to their goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg, who's literally been a fixture for this team for more than a decade in goal.
Yeah, it's not quite the same, the Milwaukee Wave, without my old teammate Keith Tozer in charge.
After 21 years, yep. Ty, no longer the coach.
Yep.
It's Juliana Oliverio. He's the head coach. Yeah. Nick Vorberg is his assistant, but as I just mentioned a second ago, he's in goal tonight. This is Stefan Saint-Louis.
Yeah, Keith Tozer and I were rookies together with
the Cincinnati kids. This is Blake Ardell for the ambush. Elvir Kafedzic, comfortable with the ball at his feet, inside in a deep position, in a tight position. And Milwaukee breaks loose. They come out very quickly. They will counter whenever they get the opportunity. That is Ian Bennett, who is very quick. One of the fastest players in the league, as a matter of fact. Number 26, Ian Bennett. That shot goes well wide, knocked out of play by Chad Vandergriff.
Well, I think Daryl Duran mentioned to you that Ian Bennett was a player that had to be matched up tightly, or he would do a lot of damage against the ambush backs.
Mm-hmm. This is Manny Forbes, comes back deeply to receive it. Another key ingredient is a tight indoor. You got to be able to play without the ball. Go find the game, make the game, get involved. Ambush having difficulty getting out of their own end. However, this is Manny Forbes now out on the left wing. Ooh, looking for number 77, yet another new player, Ross McGregor, who had charged forward. Nick Vorberg just rolls it to the feet.
Well, if you watch high-level soccer anywhere, the counterattack is a big part of the match, even more so, I think, in indoor because the field is shorter. You have to be aware of when that change of possession takes place, and you have to anticipate it and adjust for it.
And that's why Daryl said prior to the game, when the quick counters are on, go right in and do it. Go right up through the middle of the field. Make sure it's on, and when it's coming vice versa against you, watch where your man is. Chad Vandergriff plays his goalkeeper, Greg Crook. Broken up by Victor Queiroz. Nick Pollard knocks it in deep, looking for O'Dane Sinclair. He's very gifted at this, playing with his back to goal. Keeps it nicely, finds Vandergriff.
Well, the key for O'Dane Sinclair, number 12 for the ambush, is he can hold his position and hold defenders off as he controls the ball. He's got the body to do that and the strength to do it and the skill as well.
Very much so. Rookie of the year last year in the league with 12 goals and 12 assists. Corey Dowell lays it off just wide of that opposite post. A blast coming in yet again from number 4, Corey Adamson. Nicely struck.
Yeah, Adamson looks sharp, and that left foot is dangerous from long distance.
Ambush in possession now. More Obed now. This is Richard Schmerman. Has a very good left foot, powerful left foot, accurate. Number 6 is Chris Mattingly. He's in his second year with the St. Louis Ambush, went to Chaminade High School. So O'Dane Sinclair at the near post, cut out very nicely by Nick Vorberg.
Yeah, Mattingly was one of the more consistent tough defenders for the Ambush last season.
Comes into the league, as I mentioned, playing in his second year. Played for the St. Louis Illusion as well as for Piasaw, Illinois Piasaw for 3 years. Ambush last season, so he does indeed have some indoor experience. Stefan Saint-Louis inside his center circle, back to his goalkeeper, Greg Crook.
Yeah, a little bit of flair inside the center circle there by Saint-Louis.
Corey Adamson yet again tries to turn, couldn't quite do so. Marcio Lete defending for the Wave. On the attack, it's J.C. Banks. LSO in deep for Ian Bennett.
Yeah, the Milwaukee Wave applying some good midfield pressure there to force this turnover, and they still have it alive here.
This is Pablo with the shot. Good sure save by Greg Crook from Columbia, Illinois.
He looks sure. Well, you like seeing Columbia, Illinois, St. Louis players like Corey Dowell, Mattingly's a St. Louis guy. Kafezic, I guess, played here in St.
Sure.
Louis, even though he's originally from Bosnia.
That was a huge part, an immense part of the Halcyon era of the Steamers, don't you think, Ty?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you want to have St. Louis guys representing St. Louis soccer and the great history here, but you like the flair of having guys. I mean, back in the day, it was Slobo or Tony Glavin or
Manny Cuenca.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But you want to have that backbone of the team be local guys.
There's Manny Forbes for Chad Vandergriff, stripped off his feet. Chad continues to tackle, but yet again, it falls to the feet of the Milwaukee Wave. Marcio Lete, good ball on the ground. Great Crook, nice hand to get to that ball. Marcio Lete again, keeps it very nicely, comfortable in a tight position as Lete.
Excellent stop by Crook.
Victor Quiros. Rebound is blocked off of Manny Forbes. Elvir Kafetic. Knocks it off for Vandergriff. McGregor ambushed now with more possession. 4:55 remaining in this, the first quarter. 1-1 between the ambush and the visiting Milwaukee Wave. Ross McGregor trying to dig this ball, and he does just that for Sinclair. McGregor keeps it. There's a blast coming in from number 5. Corey Dowell, that goes high. Much better there from the ambush, though, Ty. They kept it nicely.
They did. McGregor working his way forward. A British kid. I want to say McGregor.
McGregor from Brayton, England.
He's got some height as well.
Yeah, he does.
He looked like he might be more suited as a central center back in the outdoor game, but he looked confident going forward and joining the attack there for the ambush.
Darrell's comfortable with his ball possession. He's very gifted on the ball. He played for the Illinois Paisaw last year. Played for Leeds United and York City Academy teams, as a matter of fact, at number 77, Ross McGregor.
The ambush already looked more composed.
Very much so.
Than they did at many stages of last season.
Many stages last year.
And the Milwaukee Wave is a quality team. So this is very hopeful for me in the early going here that the ambush have established possession. They've already got one in the net, and they seem coordinated enough and confident enough to knock the ball a bit and then go to get the ball in deep to O'Dane Sinclair, whoever might be breaking through. And quality goal by Corey Adams.
I think you brought up the key point, Ty, is that they seem much more comfortable in possession, and that's what you have to be in the indoor game.
Oh, yeah. Against good teams and good players like you're seeing here for the Milwaukee Wave, if you give up possession too easy, they're going to make you pay for it.
It's gone.
Yeah. They're going to either have you chasing to try and win it back, or you're going to be digging it out of your net.
This was a game in the Central Division. The Chicago Mustangs, the defending champion in this league, likewise in the Central. The Missouri Comets, Tulsa Revolution, and the Wichita B-52s. No longer the Wichita Wings, the Wichita B-52s. There's four conferences, the Eastern, the Central, the Southern, the Pacific. 21 United States teams, two teams from Mexico, Monterrey and Saltillo. Those two teams very close to each other. You told me, Ty, in Mexico, Saltillo and Monterrey.
They're probably farther apart in elevation than they are in distance.
much more in elevation. Yeah, yeah. Wave now in possession. They get forward.
Rebounds off the near post. You go to play in Saltillo, you're going to need some oxygen on the bench.
You're going to know
about 6,000 feet high.
Marcelo tries to get it forward. There's a hard tackle coming in from number 23, Axel Duarte. Yet another new player for the St. Louis Ambush. There's Chris Mattingly. There's the aforementioned Axel Duarte from Caracas, Venezuela.
And Mattingly with the captain's armband?
Yes, sir.
Yep. That tells you something about his performance last year for the ambush.
Darrell very happy with this play. Talked about Chris Mattingly, went to Chaminade, played for St. Louis Scott Gallagher, went to Drury University. 3 years with the Illinois Paisaw. Number 6, Chris Mattingly, the team captain. Walking now into center circle, back to the goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg, the assistant coach as well for this year's Milwaukee Wave edition. Deep into the left corner, looking for number 8, Bato. Bato with his back to goal, cleared up by Adamson, only momentarily. That fell to the feet of Tony Walls, but no difficulty for Greg Crook. He looked for Stefan Saint-Louis, from Corey Adamson.
Almost threaded the needle,
That almost worked. This is a lineup that Daryl Duran wants to see on the floor at one time. Adamson, number 4, Saint-Louis, number 10, and Sinclair, number 12. Chris Mattingly now.
And obviously, Corey Madison likes his left foot. It seems like the more creative and better passing players many times are left-footed. They're a little more artistic.
You see him right away. You notice him right away. Case in point, Brad Davis, speaking of great St. Louis players from the past. Here's Stefan Saint-Louis. Cross the goalpost. Yes, it's there! Stefan Saint-Louis made it. Number 81, Blake Ordell from Hawaii, gets the go-ahead goal for the ambush. His first of the year, and obviously his first as an ambush player. Number 81, Blake Ordell.
Excellent finish by Blake Ordell, but how about the dancing by Saint-Louis in the corner there? As he created that goal here. Look, he dances past one defender, slips in, and then beautifully ball cut back for Ordell to finish with his left foot. But that is pretty much setting the table. San Luis sets the table for Ordell.
So Blake Gardell played his college soccer in England and Pennsylvania, a 7-year pro veteran. And he showed some of that veteran pedigree there, very calm in a tight situation in the penalty area. There's that same goal again, nicely put away by number 81, Blake Gardell.
And I'd give most of the credit, really, to Stefan St. Louis. He danced past his defender. Another good save there by Crook again. And a push.
And one of the first things I asked Daryl Duran about the team this year, what's the main area of improvement? He said depth at the forward position. Case in point, Stefan St. Louis. Wonderful job there, assisting on the goal by Blake Gardell. It's 2-1 in favor of the Ambush. 2:47 remaining in this the first quarter.
Well, I agree with Daryl there. It takes a lot of the weight off of the shoulders of O'Dane Sinclair, who was expected to do just about everything offensively last season for the Ambush.
Exactly. Anytime that the Ambush went forward, they were always looking for number 12.
And the other team started to figure that
positively,
out.
Positively, yeah. Very quickly. He did finish with 12 goals and 12 assists, but he took a lot of punishment playing with his back to goal.
Yep.
Long ball caught by Nick Vorberg. As I mentioned, he's likewise the assistant coach, 4-time All-Star in goal.
It looked to me like he may have handled the ball outside the line.
It certainly looked like it. Tony Walls plays it square to his right side teammate in deep as Bato. Bato for Pablo. On the turn, Bato was thinking about hitting that first time. Couldn't quite do so. Ambush get back to defend. Elvira Kafedzic. Long ball in from LSO. Cleared very nicely by Richard Schmierman. But it's directly to the feet of Victor Quiros. Back to the goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg, with 1:57 remaining in this, the first quarter.
Seen a handful of players have trouble with their footing.
Mm-hmm. Shot at the near post. Greg Crook cuts it out. Very nicely done by Bato. He cut that out very nicely across the goal mouth. Greg Crook alert to react. Chad Vandegrift tries to find Stefan St. Louis. Couldn't quite dig it out. Not Ambush. Back again to defend. This is Marcio Lete. Greg Crook again at the near post. Very sure-handed is Greg Crook.
Very clean. Yep. You like to see that. It gives the defenders in front of him a lot of confidence that they know he'll handle the routine balls.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all you want out of a goalkeeper. Every once in a while make a phenomenal save, but don't give a goal away.
Come up with a showstopper occasionally.
Yeah.
Deep Owen looking for Ross McGregor. Gonzalez Oliveira, LSO trying to clear. He's got the lone goal for the Milwaukee Wave. He's fouled in the process going forward. Be a free kick for the Wave. 1:03 remaining in this, the first quarter. 2-1 in favor of the Ambush. That's the referee Ron Corey for tonight's match.
But we've seen quality goals here.
Very much so.
Really good strikes or good runs through the box. No, nothing fluke about any of the goals we've seen.
Goals for the Ambush by Corey Adamson and Blake Ordell. It makes it 2-1. LSO, Gonzalez Oliveira. He has the lone goal for the Milwaukee Wave. This is Marcio Leite at the left point.
Good double Adamson team there.
Clears very nicely. O'Dane Sinclair, who's off to the races immediately. Number 12, Sinclair, deep into the right corner. Good running from Sinclair.
See how strong he is.
Holds off that last defender very easily. Tries to take him on, couldn't quite do so, but wins a foul in the process. No, it's ruled that he does the fouling.
A bit of a wrestling match going on there. The call goes against O'Dane Sinclair. Sinclair, if he'd have picked his head up initially when he first was making the break, Adamson was making another excellent run.
40 seconds left in this, the first quarter. Ambush still on top by a score of 2-1. On the turn, this is LSO. Gonzalez Oliveira. He has the lone goal for the Wave.
He likes his left foot.
He's very quick into the dribble. Nice ball in a very tight space. Greg Crook cut it out nicely at the near post. On the rebound. That's it. That's the end of the first quarter. The Ambush successful. They're on top by a score of 2-1. Goals by Corey Adamson and Blake Gardell, assisted beautifully by Stefan St. Louis. But I think, Ty Keogh, one of the things you brought up in that first quarter is that you're seeing already some much-needed improvement from the St. Louis Ambush.
I think it's also important, especially at home, get that first goal. Mm-hmm. Gets the crowd a little bit into it. Gives you a little bit of confidence. Your head doesn't drop like it did so many times last season for the St. Louis Ambush. So a positive start. Hopefully they can build on it. Certainly Milwaukee will try to regroup.
Yeah. Because Darryl said at the end of the year last year, he just says, obviously I'm not satisfied with this. The players aren't satisfied with this. They're professional athletes. They don't want any part of losing 16 out of 20 games. So we're going to come back and attempt to improve. And one of the things also that Darryl mentioned to me, Ty, at training on Tuesday morning was that you got to look now. This is just a 20-game season. You guys played a lot more games than that.
Yeah, we played a 56-game season a couple years in the MISL. Yeah.
So this is just the second season of 20 games.
Well, each game means that much more.
Some of these young players are literally still learning the sport.
Right. Especially home games, you got to get your points. It's going to be tough on the road.
It's imperative you get points at home.
So every home game becomes that much more critical on that short of the season.
And you have a very difficult division. Two defending champions, Missouri Comets, of the league that the Ambush was in last year, and the league in which we are now, the Chicago Mustangs, they're the defending champions. You also play against Tulsa and Wichita. So this is a very difficult Central Division. Yeah, Eastern Division, our old favorites, the Baltimore Blast, Harrisburg Heat, the Rochester Lancers, team from Syracuse, the Silver Knights, the Detroit Wazza, they're also in the league. Southern Division tie, Brownsville, the Dallas Sidekicks, coached by Tattoo. He's back in action.
He'd probably like to come out and play. He
wants to play.
He probably could for a few minutes.
Hidalgo La Fiera, they're also in the Southern Division. Monterey, Oxford City of Texas, and Saltillo. We talked about those two Mexican teams. The Pacific Division, Las Vegas, Ontario, Sacramento, San Diego, Seattle, and the Turlock Express, located very close to Sacramento. So a different look this year. This league was founded at the 18th of May in 2008. As I mentioned, the Chicago Mustangs are the current champs. This is the MASL, the Major Arena Soccer League, formerly known as the Professional Arena Soccer League. So it's a new look. There are some new rules and a lot of new players for the St. Louis Ambush.
I think it's fantastic to coordinate and to have a continental footprint. Mm-hmm. That's what you're talking about. Teams in Mexico, teams in the Midwest, teams on either coast. Mm-hmm. It really gets your name out there. You've got just more regions of the country taking part and starting to notice what's going on with indoor or arena soccer.
That is Ty Keough. I'm Bill McDermott. We're at the St. Charles Family Arena for the second season of St. Louis Ambush Indoor Soccer. We're on the Gateway Television Network. I'm going to be with you a goodly portion of the year for all the home games. Another difficult opponent coming up next Saturday night. Next Saturday night, the Chicago Mustangs. We talked about them. They're defending champions in this league before it changed. So they'll be in town next Saturday night. And on the 22nd, the Ambush leaves town. Then they go up to Milwaukee to play the Milwaukee Wave.
Bill, the two men over the ball right now each had an assist in that first quarter and really set up nice goals for the Ambush.
And Darryl Durant said he was really looking forward to seeing O'Day and Sinclair and Stephane Saint-Louis play together.
Yeah, they're on the field together right now.
That was a hard tackle, O'Day and Sinclair.
You know, I was afraid Sinclair got the worst
Likewise.
Of it
yeah,
initially, he but he, yeah. he's strong.
He went into a block ball.
Yeah. Yeah, you never like to see this, especially there was no physical contact other than both of them on the ball.
On the ball at the same time. Yeah. That man in the foreground, number 12, O'Dane Sinclair, he was the guy on the tackle. Let's take another look again, Ty, as how that developed. It was O'Dane Sinclair going into the tackle for the Ambush.
Yeah, loose ball pops off the boards. It's loose now. Sinclair comes in. Mike, you know what? He came through the ball, but slightly over it as he came through, and that's where the contact was made. So my initial reading of it was incorrect. There was actual contact between Sinclair's foot and the player's left leg, it looked like.
This is Tony Walls being escorted off the field. We'll see if he returns, but that was a really hard tackle between Tony Walls, number 15, and number 12, O'Dane Sinclair. As a matter of fact, holding his neck a bit with Rawls as he walks up. He felt everything on that tackle.
It registered seismically.
Just at the outset of the second quarter, ambush on top of the visiting Milwaukee Way by a score of 2-1. This is Marcelo Fontana, the team captain for the Milwaukee Wave. Chad Vandergriff inside his center circle. Darryl Durant said he'd like to see Chad get forward, but please don't lose sight of the fact that you're a defender first. Manny Forbes nicely done on the ball. Axel Duarte. Well, it's back to the goalkeeper, Greg Crook. Manny Forbes comes back, get the game, shows for it very nicely.
They timed that change pretty well. You're getting some fresh legs out there.
Chris Mattingly coming off the field. Into the ground. Oh, Stefan Saint-Louis couldn't quite find Corey Adamson. But the ambush keep it in their own half of the field offensively. Stefan Saint-Louis good on the ball. Nice tackle from number 16, Anthony Arrico for the Wave. They get forward now. They tried to break out. They couldn't quite do so because the ambush got back very alertly. Marcelo Fontana. Wave now coming out of their own backfield. They're just content to keep it. They play their goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. At the top of the penalty area arc. Now the Wave pick up the pace ever so slightly. It's Marcelo Fontana to the goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg, who, as I mentioned, has been the man in goal for Milwaukee for literally more than a decade. 13:35 remaining in the second quarter as they send a long ball in. Milwaukee Wave do. Looking for number 15. He seems to be okay. That's Tony Walls, who was just in a tackle moments ago with O'Dane Sinclair. That man in your camera right there was Nick Pollard, starting in defense for the St. Louis ambush.
Well, Bill, you mentioned how critical it is for goalkeepers to have foot skills. And it's more emphasized, obviously, in arena soccer or indoor soccer. The goalkeepers have to not only be able to take a back pass from one of their defenders to relieve pressure, they then also have to confidently distribute the ball with their feet.
Ball stuck, as you can see, between the netting and the play. That's it, everybody. Good night. Drive safely. That's the only ball we have. We've got another ball.
Bill, you're showing your age there. When we used to show up with two or three balls. now even the
that's
the,
it.
Yeah, the eight-year-old show up with 30 balls
exactly.
For practice. You know, so.
All of which are different colors, may we add. Second quarter. Home opener for the St. Louis Ambush in this 2014-15 season. We're on the Gateway Television Network. I'm Bill McDermott alongside is Ty Keel, former player with the St. Louis Steamers as well as the United States national team. A little more pressure now being applied by the Ambush. Milwaukee tries to get it out of their own backfield. They do, but only momentarily. Chad Vandergriff defending. Falls for Kafedzic. Back to Vandergriff. Ball on the ground. Yes, good shot. Coming in from number 77, Ross McGregor. Seems calm and composed on the ball, does McGregor.
A good pass in from Kafedzic, yes, as well, though.
There's a good ball on the ground coming out of the backfield from the goalkeeper, Greg Crook. Manny Forbes, good use of his speed. This is Stefan Saint-Louis. Back to Manny Forbes, who started this particular play.
Saint-Louis got a really good move to his right, and he's used it well.
He prefers to go that way, does number 10, Stefan Saint-Louis. Manny Forbes draws the foul there for the St. Louis Ambush. Free kick with 12:22 remaining in this, the first half. Ambush on top by a score of 2-1 on goals by Corey Adamson and Blake Ordell. Mattingly for Blake Ordell. He did much better with the goal he scored than that.
The goal he scored with his left, I think.
Yeah, uh-huh. The Ambush mascot, he'll be here at every home game. The players will stick around after the game. They're very receptive to being actively involved in the community. That was number 6, Chris Mattingly defending. He draws the foul. Free kick for the Ambush. Deep in their own half of the field.
Well, the pace has settled down a little bit compared. It was pretty hectic in that first quarter.
Long ball flighted, looking for either Saint-Louis or Corey Adamson. Couldn't find either. This is Anthony Arrico for the Wave. They play a long ball out of their own backfield, do the Wave. Looking for number 15, Tony Walls. Couldn't quite control. Ambush in possession now. They're up by a score of 2-1.
the Ambush are showing good patience here. They're not going for the throat on every attack. They're keeping some possession, building some confidence, I think. Mm-hmm. And I think they realized that last year in this situation, they would be going for more goals and leaving themselves susceptible and open to counterattacks.
And so many times last year, as you pointed out, that they were chasing the game very early.
No, here they've got the lead. They're going to consolidate it a little bit.
This is Ian Bennett for the Wave. Tony Walls coming in off the left point for Bennett again. The Wave content just to keep it here. Good possession.
But this just looks like a more mature approach by the Ambush. In other words, let's not give anything up here.
Don't give up. Don't dive in, as you just talked about, Ty. Don't go chasing.
Yep.
Take a little rest here if you can. In deep by the Milwaukee Wave. This is number 8, Bato. Bato with his back to play. Lays it off for Jonathan Greenfield. Greenfield plays the way he's facing to Victor Quiroz. There's a good ball on the ground. Quiroz continues his run off the near post. Boards! Number 26, yes, it's there. Ian Bennett with the equalizer. Very nicely engineered by the visiting Milwaukee Wave.
And a breakdown in defending by the Ambush. The runner not tracked ended up being instrumental in creating the goal. So better defensive discipline would have definitely paid off there by the Ambush, and they paid the price.
And you'll see that right here, Ty. The lone runner, he's vacant, and you'll see it develop here.
Over to the left side, he runs in with no one on him. Not so much the goal scorer, Bill. That initial player that started the ball into the attack, then filtered in, and then banged it off the boards. He was unopposed.
He ran in, coming off from the right point, right into his path at his feet, struck it first time. And that's an equalizer for the Milwaukee Wave with 10:51 remaining in the second quarter, in the first half. Elvira Kafedzic, Manny Forbes, new player for the St. Louis Ambush. He wears number 20, Manny Forbes, from Southern Wesleyan University. This is Elvira Kafedzic. With the ball at his feet, number 9, Kafedzic.
He likes his right foot.
Yes, he does.
He had a chance to shoot with the left there.
Tried to get over to his more favorite right foot. Now on the break, it's a Milwaukee Wave. Marcio Leyte, be careful of him! Shot at the near post. Great crook again, very comfortable. Doesn't get excited. Just hold on, keep it.
Well positioned.
Yep. Good ball on the ground to the feet of Odin Sinclair, who came back to show, received it nicely. Sinclair keeps it on the dribble. Finds Corey Adamson. Can Adamson click with Sinclair and Saint-Louis? Richard Schmerman to the team captain, Chris Mattingly. Ball flatted in for Odane Sinclair. Broken up by Jonathan Greenfield. Ambush keep it nicely. This is Stefan Saint-Louis. Coming deep out of their own area. This is Pablo for the Milwaukee Wave. Knocks it back to his goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg, with 9:33 remaining in this second quarter. Still 2-2. Ian Bennett just tied it up moments ago for the visiting Milwaukee Wave.
This is a pretty good back line for the Ambush. Vandegrift is smart. The captain playing out there with him, Mattingly, they coordinate well at the back for the Ambush.
So the defenders are Chad Vandegrift, Chris Mattingly, Nick Powell, and Richard Schmerman. Axel Duarte, he rotates in and out. We saw him in a moment ago. Now Milwaukee keeps it inside the defensive half of the field in the St. Louis Ambush. Victor Quiroz. On the left point, this is number 10. LSO, Juan Salas Oliveira. Balls into the feet of number 8, Bato. Tried to rebound it off the near post boards, couldn't quite do so.
Keeping the pressure on.
They really are. They get the ball back as soon as possible. They did it right there. Anthony Arrico for the Wave. This is Tony Walls, 8:30 remaining in the second quarter. Victor Quiroz.
Walls, the player that was injured in the tackle with Odane Sinclair, so it's good to see him back out.
Seems to be okay.
Yeah.
Quiroz back to his goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. Way very comfortable with the ball at their feet. They're content to keep it now. But Ambush, as you said, Ty, a moment ago, as opposed to last year when they would chase, just dropping back defensively, keeping a sense of ardor.
Lock down the spaces.
Chad Vandegrift defending, coming out of his own backfield. Falls, however, to the feet of J.C. Banks. to Quiros. JC Banks, Quiros comes off, new player comes on. And Vorberg leaves it for him. This is Pablo. JC Banks! Shot from distance by JC Banks. And I think we're going to have a timeout with 2-2 the scoreline, 7:24 remaining in the first half. I'm Bill McDermott alongside is Ty Keogh. We're on the Gateway Television Network. St. Louis Ambush Soccer for their second year here at the St. Charles Family Arena. Seems to be a nice crowd on hand, Ty.
Yeah, they're into it. They've seen some quality goals by both teams. And right now, a little bit of a chess match, I think, between these two teams. Yeah. Gerald Durant trying to maybe shift things, maybe correct a couple things so that we're not as vulnerable. Because Milwaukee does pressure. When they win the ball, they do get into the attack very quickly, and the Ambush have to be alert to that.
In the real heyday of the Steamerstown, when you guys won the ball in the back, did you look long first? Did you want to counter right away if possible?
Well, if Denny Vaniger or Greg Villa was up there, you did. They could maul people.
Yes.
Glavin on a quick break or if Ebert, with his back to the goal, was strong enough to hold off defenders, yeah, you did. Uh-huh. I mean, why not?
Yeah. You mentioned, because of the configuration of the venue you're playing. It's on almost always to go forward immediately.
Well, if you have confidence that the player you're playing in on a longer ball can hold possession long enough to get support, then you do it. And if you have the confidence, you have the accuracy to put it on a protected side to that attacking player so that the defender is shielded away from the ball.
After that timeout by the Milwaukee Ways, let's see if they engineered anything in particular in this dead ball scenario. It's J.C. Banks for Jonathan Greenfield. Greenfield going ahead on the dribble. He's fouled in the process.
Bill, even when I play now, if I play with Daryl, I can play it to his protected side. Nobody's going to take it away from Daryl, right? Or P. Colico.
You know he's going to keep it.
On P. Colico's protected side. Nobody's going to take that ball away.
Nobody's going to take it. Now, you better hope that he keeps it. Here's that last foul as Jonathan Greenfield was going forward.
Clear bump with the hip there in the corner.
Going into the near post boards. But you better hope that Pete can keep it because he's not going to chase it if he loses it.
He'll root for the defenders to come up with it. Yeah.
Get that back to me. I'll show far. Just get it to me.
You were mentioning great left-footed players in St. Louis like a Brad Davis. How about Tim Logish back in the day?
One of the all-time greatest.
What a silky smooth left foot.
That was that foul just whistled up a moment ago as Jonathan Greenfield tried to get forward. Marcio Leyte did likewise.
And if you don't mention another, you got to mention Mark Moser's left foot. Too.
Of course.
I mean, come on.
We saw him in some of the highlights prior to the game starting.
I mean, he could splinter the boards with that.
And another guy who could really keep the ball nicely, rolled it with the sole of his shoe, was very confident in tight space.
Yep.
There's Joe Smigala, Daryl Durant's assistant coach. Second year in a row. Corey Edison getting the drink of water. He's the guy who scored the first goal.
Smigala is looking a little more stylish. Daryl's got that early hitman look that J.P. Della Camera used to call it that. The black shirt and the dark tie. But
the monochromatic look. Milwaukee Wave now in possession, just about at the corner flag. Marcio Leyte lays it off for LSO. In possession now, Milwaukee, they're very comfortable in doing this. It looks like they're playing with the man advantage, but they just do so well keeping it. Their first thought is to do just that, keep it. This is Jonathan Greenfield. Alongside of him, defensively, is Marcio Leyte. And he has possession of the ball right now. Two guys to really watch, Daryl Durant told me, was this guy, Marcio Leyte, as well as number 26, Ian Bennett. Shot from Leyte, coming up from his right back position, just over the top of the crossbar. Number 10, LSO, digs it out across the goal mouth. Gray Cook, one save, then it rebounds past the near post boards.
Outstanding save. I don't think he saw it right away. He had to just spread his body, and he was able to cut the angle enough that the ball hit him.
Defense by self-defense by that man, Gray Cook. This is Ian Bennett. We talked about him just a moment ago. Very comfortable inside the center circle, running at defenders. Coming back is Stephon Saint-Louis. Plays it to his captain, Chris Mattingly. With 6:11 remaining in this, the first half. Still 2-2 between the visiting Milwaukee Wave and your St. Louis Ambush. Kafedzic on the ground for Sinclair. O'Dane Sinclair with the blast just over the top of the crossbar. And simply clearing the ball out as Marciolete, as they make a change, the Milwaukee Wave does. Axel Duarte gets a turn now defensively for the St. Louis Ambush. Nick Pollard with a long ball to the right wing corner flag, looking for number 81, Blake Gardell. He has the second goal for the St. Louis Ambush. Nick Vorberg attempts to clear it, tried to do that long first. Couldn't quite link up with number 2, Tenzin Rampa. Very comfortable now keeping the ball or the St. Louis Ambush. This is Chad Vandegrift. At the left point defensively from the Ambush. Greg Crook, good ball on the ground, but it's cut out very alertly by Pablo. Pablo tries to get forward, nothing on, so the Wave keeps it inside the center circle. This is Tony Walls. On the ground for Marcelo Fontana. Milwaukee Wave just taking advantage of keeping the ball here, but it breaks loose for Manny Forbes. Can he use his speed here? It's number 20, Manny Forbes, coming on very alertly. Ooh, look at this shot, just wide of the near post. That was Mattingly getting forward defensively, coming out at the fence. Now Mattingly again at the near post. Good save by Nick Vorberg.
Kafedzic was open on the back post too.
Corey Dowell tried to keep it, taken off his feet. Milwaukee sends it in deep, looking for number 20, Marcelo Fontana. Oldest guy on the field by a large margin. I mentioned the first quarter, 41 years of age. Kafedzic with his back to play for Vandegrift. Can he keep it? Not quite, but he breaks loose to Greg Crook. Tried to send it long, and Jonathan Greenfield just lets it run for his goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. 4:14 remaining in this, the first half. 2-2 between the Wave and the Ambush. Now a bit more urgency with Milwaukee going forward. Free kick and a foul whistled up against number 4, Corey Adamson.
Ambush had a good, quick counter going with Forbes, showing that speed, and we're not able to convert.
Good shot on the turn by Bato. Likewise, a great save by Greg Crook, who seems very sure of himself on the goal line, or coming out, or with his feet. With this ball to O'Dane Sinclair, who comes back to find the game. Plays the ball off in the left flank for Stephon Saint-Louis. This is Corey Adamson. Can he turn and get a shot? He can't quite do so.
The early ball was a good decision by Saint-Louis, but the execution was off. It was behind Adamson.
So he couldn't hit it first time. This is Bato, rebounding off the near post boards. Cleared by Richard Sherman.
Goes out of play. That last play for the Ambush developed very well, but just a lack of precision on Saint-Louis' pass was enough to break it down.
They got forward there nicely, and they did so quickly. Now they're forced to defend. This is number 10, Elso, Luan Salas Oliveira. He leaves it for Marciolete. Quick ball, furnished back to Marciolete.
That was a pretty well-coordinated kick.
Very nicely done. Did it in a tight space. It didn't come off, but they still keep it, does the Milwaukee Wave going forward. And a shot just wide from Pablo. He got forward offensively. Wave now keeping it again. Thanks for Pablo. Marciolete. Deep into the half of the St. Louis Ambush of the Milwaukee Wave. Doing the chasing is Marciolete. Kafedzic back to defend. Tries to find Blake Ordell. Can't quite do so. Wave simply keeping it, using their goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. 2:48 remaining in this, the first half. 2-2. One of these teams looking for a go-ahead to take it into the halftime interval. Vorberg, goalkeeper slash assistant coach for Juliana Oliverio, the new head coach for the Milwaukee Wave. LSO for the Ambush. He has one goal so far in the first half. Simply steps off. New player comes on. Nick Vorberg plays that new player. Walls for Fontana. Kiros. Milwaukee Wave really content to keep it now, and the Ambush likewise content just to drop back and defend. Not gambling, as you said, Ty, not diving into anything are the St. Louis Ambush.
Yeah. Under 2 minutes remaining in the half, too. It's a critical time, I think, psychologically to stay in this game, not give anything away.
Keeping the ball is the Wave. Kiros back to Nick Vorberg. Celtics down to 146 remaining in the first half. As the ambush picks it up a bit with their intensity defensively. Richard Schmerman back to his goalkeeper, Greg Crook. Good ball on the ground, but cut out very alertly by J.C. Banks from the Milwaukee Wave. He gets forward, and yes, it's there. Number 29, J.C. Banks, into the near post. And very, very nicely done by the visiting Milwaukee Wave as they go up by a score of 3-2.
Well, in so many situations, Bill, shooting far post is the thing to do. So many good things can happen, especially if you've got an alert attacking player who likes to camp out near the back post. Watch this.
J.C. Banks finds
Marcio Lete. It's a good place to be because it's there for the tap-in. That's a Tom Malley goal there.
Boy, is it ever.
Yeah, score from the 12, 15 inches out, but being positioned there ahead of time, a deflection, a save by the goalkeeper, you're there for the rebound or the low hard ball to the back post. It's an easy finish.
So all that composure, all that possession did indeed pay off for the Milwaukee Wave with 1:20 left. In the first half, they go on top by a score of 3-2, and that most recent goal by Marcio Lete off a beautiful assist from J.C. Banks. Literally a tap-in. This is Corey Dowell for the ambush. Good shot by Greg Crook.
Ball was loaded.
Nice save by that assistant coach. Goalkeeper Nick Vorberg now coming deep out of their own half. This is Jonathan Greenfield, but a foul just wide of the center circle. Number 29, yeah. J.C. Banks was fouled.
Behind the play. But...
Well, we'll set up against Milwaukee.
40 seconds.
And the ambush will keep it. 42.2 remaining in the first half. Chad Vandergrift just plays it to his goalkeeper, Greg Frook. Will it be long or will it be at somebody's feet? He was looking for Stefan Saint-Louis. Comes back, tries the heel pass for Corey Adamson. Couldn't quite connect. The Milwaukee now just content to clear it as they do so with 27 seconds remaining. They're on top by a score of 3-2.
The Ambush have their most dangerous trio, at least tonight, on the field right now, looking to get an equalizer before half.
0-8 Sinclair for Corey Adamson. Adamson has Vandergrift to his right. Chad advances, plays 0-8 Sinclair, whose shirt is being tugged literally as he tried to turn. Vandergrift on the turn, plays it back to his goalkeeper, Greg Crook, Corey Adamson, and time is going to run out, and that is the halftime whistle with the score 3-2 in favor of the visiting Milwaukee Wave. A most recent goal scored by Marcio Lete from J.C. Banks, and that's where it stands at halftime, 3-2 in favor of the Milwaukee Wave.
Disappointing to give up the goal with less than 2 minutes in the half, but I think something to build on for the Ambush. I mean, they again look to be a more sure, mature, organized team, not getting stretched out, only going forward when it was on rather than forcing it every time.
A lot of times last year, Ty, we talked about this in the first or second quarters in situations just like this. Oh no, we're tied, we're losing at home, we've got to get on top. Let's just at random go forward, leaving yourself totally exposed in the back.
And indoor is so different than outdoor soccer. Literally, the game could turn around. The whole momentum can shift so quickly, and goals can come quickly as well. Deflections, you know, any shot's dangerous, because even shots that are wide are back in play when you think about it. So you want to encourage just getting shots low and people following up into those lanes to finish them off. But the fact is, if you panic and you give up possession, or you get stretched out, better teams like Milwaukee will exploit those spaces, and now you're in trouble. You're chasing the game, as you said.
Isn't that one of the real keys in this indoor game time? You just can't panic. You have to be comfortable with the ball at your feet.
Well, you have to be, because this field is so short that if you panic, lose possession, you paid the price almost instantaneously. So you have to have that composure. You have to be able to decide when to take a chance, when not to take a chance. And indoor is so fun because you could be down by 3 goals with 3 minutes to go, and you could turn it around.
Boom, boom, boom.
In an outdoor game, that's really not going to happen, is it?
No, that's not going to happen. Yeah. And one of the things that We had talked about Stefan Saint-Louis and Odane Sinclair playing together along with Corey Adamson. As we look down at the field, these are some of the existing members of the St. Louis Soccer Hall of Fame being recognized by the St. Louis Ambush. And the guy speaking as we turn to our right, that is Jim Linker, the president of the St. Louis Ambush. Let's see what Jim has to say. The man that we just panned away from there is Al Trost, member of the United States National Soccer Hall of Fame. Tom Pollahan with his green coat. Austin Gomez, what did Jim Linker say? One of the best referees he's ever seen? Hold on. There's Mike Barnstead, a new addition to the Soccer Hall of Fame, an avid fan. Kyle Weinrich, who plays for Tony Glavine's St. Louis Lions team, and as Jim said, every year time we try to honor four future stars.
The gentleman all the way on the left, next to Al Trost, the very white hair, with the hat, Pete Sorber, one of the deans of American soccer coaching.
There's the
Pete
lineup.
Pete Sorber with the cap on next to Al Trost at the top of your screen.
John Schneider walking off there has been very active with Spencer. There's Mark Demling pointing up to the crowd. One of the all-time greats at St. Louis University. Played in four NCAA finals, that prolific class of 1970 at St. Louis University, Ty. Your dad coached that team with Mark Demling, Bob Madison, Dan Counts, Jim Gutman, Tom Turetti,
Denny Werner.
Jim Bolkern, Denny Werner. Yep. That was a magnificent class. Yep. When you get in four NCAA finals, winning three of them, and actually the fourth one was vacated because Howard at the time used an eligible player as, and I love the comment by your dad at the time when the NCAA wanted to present the trophy to St. Louis University as opposed to Howard because they used an eligible player, St. Louis U came in second. Your dad said, no, we're not going to take a trophy because the title was negated by somebody using eligible players. However, we will play Howard with some of our ineligible players. Cerisi, McBride, Gentile. Yeah. So it's at halftime. We're at the St. Charles Family Arena. The score is 3-2 in favor of the visiting Milwaukee Wave. We'll be back with more action the second half right after this. This is St. Louis Ambush Soccer on the Gateway Television Network. Welcome back to the St. Charles Family Arena. I'm Bill McDermott alongside his Ty Keel for this, the second season of St. Louis Ambush Soccer here at the St. Charles Family Arena. New league, a lot of new players, some new rules, and a much improved St. Louis Ambush as they trail by a score of 3-2 over the visiting Milwaukee Wave, Ty. Big improvement in this team.
Yes, they played with a lot more confidence, looked good in the attack, did not take too many chances to get stretched out. And the good thing, too, this year, Bill, a goal counts for 1 point.
Exactly, yeah.
We don't have to get out our calculators.
No. So 3-2, the Wave takes that one goal lead into the second half. Odane Sinclair up top with Stefan Saint-Louis. And Corey Adamson doing the running in midfield. Long ball into the defensive third of the St. Louis Ambush by the goalkeeper. Nick Vorberg headed clear by Chad Vandegrift. Chad's in the backfield, and he starts in the backfield in the second half with number 23, Axel Duarte.
Duarte was getting more and more time
as
the first half went along.
He played for FC Bordeaux earlier this year. This will be a free kick from the top of the penalty area arc to be struck by number 77, Marcio Leite. Lays it off. The quick shot just past the near post boards and then the far post. Milwaukee Way very comfortable and very crafty with these free kick plays.
Well, that's something we haven't really highlighted, but the fact how important set plays are in soccer, especially in arena soccer. Mm-hmm. And Daryl Durand's teams historically, you know, going back with all the way back with the Ambush and with the Steamers, have been always very proficient.
Yes, very much so.
Very well rehearsed in their set plays, and we expect to see more of that for the Ambush this season.
Yeah, they did quite a bit of work on a Tuesday morning here at this exact venue in preparation for this home opener. But they trail right now by a score of 3-2. That was another foul by Odane Sinclair. He clearly got away with that. Nick Vorberg to the feet of Marcio Leite. Leite has that third, and as of right now, that go-ahead goal for the visiting Milwaukee Wave. Just underway here in the second half. As the Ambush really trying to get back into the flow of being one of the better teams in this league, and certainly one of the better teams in the Central Division, and this is one of the teams they're going to have to be successful against. Greg Crook out of his own backfield, trying to find Manny.
Good block there by Vandegrift for the Ambush. The Ambush just looked more confident.
Very much so, Ty. Yeah.
I mean, they looked like they were lost large parts of their they were an expansion team, and they looked like it.
Yeah. Good heel pass for Marcelo Fontana. What a magnificent save by Greg Crook as Marcelo Fontana got forward very nicely on that 1-2. Wonderful save by Greg Crook. Manny Forbes, yes! On the breakaway from Manny Forbes!
How many times do you see that, Bill McDermott? A big stop, a big save at one end, translates almost instantaneously as a momentum changer and a goal at the other end.
That's exactly
the Ambush taking full advantage.
Exactly, Ty, what transpired there. Manny Forbes starts it.
Yeah, big save, and this is a nice finish. Keeps it low, driven, just under the goalkeeper's right foot, and you like to see the Ambush capitalize on the quick break like that, but it's the big save there by Greg Crook that starts it off.
What did you say in the first quarter, Ty? I'm quoting almost exactly. You want to see your goalkeeper make the simple saves and occasionally come up with a miraculous one.
That was one of them.
That was one of them. Now the Ambush trying to get forward again. Blake Gardell gets his second of the evening. That's the third for the Ambush, and that's an equalizer with 12:50 left in this third quarter. LSO.
Game's opening up.
Very much so. Very quickly now as the Wave content to usually keep it on possession, really getting forward quickly. And the Ambush now again dropping back, not doing a lot of senseless chasing. This is Jonathan Greenfield. Forward, back, now again forward. Quiros looking for Bato. Bato with his back to play, now lays it off for 23. Quiros, who started this particular play. Good ball in and the ground for number 16, Anthony Orrico. Anthony Orrico from the Milwaukee Wave, very nicely done with his back to play.
That's a difficult skill. He exhibited it perfectly. Hold the defender off, muscle him a little bit, spin him, and then on the full turn, a low, quick shot into the far corner. That's a quality goal.
Victor Quiros started it all. Ty, good ball on the ground to his feet.
Yeah, he threaded the needle there. Watch this. He just spins the defender, takes the hit, keeps his balance. Excellent balance and strength there, and good placement on the shot as well.
Wonderful placement into the opposite side netting. Wonderful go-ahead goal by Anthony Orrico, number 16 for the Milwaukee Wave. They now lead by a score of 4-3, 12:06 remaining in this, the third quarter. So both teams trade goals. And the Wave now, they drop back defensively as the Ambush are going to show a little possession of their own here. Axel Duarte for Stephane Saint-Louis. A bit deeper now is number 10, Saint-Louis. Played last year with the Missouri Comets, very successful for them. Duarte runs past and through the center circle over to the left point again. This is number 5, Corey Dahl. Taking off his feet, J.C. Banks defending. They turn, they go forward now. This is LSO. Good ball on the ground for Marcelo Fontana! Marcelo Fontana with a blast into the upper netting from the opposite side left flank into the over the left shoulder of Greg Crook. That's a nice goal.
Well, Bill, one of the only times we've seen that shape up where it was a numbers down situation for the Ambush. It was 3 attackers against 2. We haven't seen this almost the whole game because the Ambush have been pretty disciplined and have been pretty well organized. But that's a quality shot. You can't blame the goalkeeper on that. But you do wonder, how does it break down so that it's such a clear 3-on-2?
And that happened quickly with number 12, Pablo, putting the Milwaukee Wave on now by a 2-goal margin, 5-3. And Daryl Durant talking to his players. Now there you see the score line with 11:26 remaining in this, the third quarter, 5-3 in favor of the visiting Ambush. Be content, watch it going forward, probably something of that nature, Daryl's saying. And if you do go forward, they get it quickly in a counter. Watch where your man is, get back defensively. That's what didn't happen right there.
Yeah, our cover for each other. I mean, there is a time for a defender to get into the attack, but someone has to circulate around and cover for him should the ball change hands.
So Anthony Errico with the 4th goal for the visiting Milwaukee Wave. Pablo with the 5th, and that's where it stands right now, 5-3 after Blake Ordell earlier in the second half got his 2nd of the evening to make it an equalizer at 3-3 at the time. That's Corey Adamson, who has the 1st goal of the evening for the St. Louis Ambush. He's back on now with Odane Sinclair and Elvir Kafedzic. This is the goalkeeper, Greg Crook. A long ball to the left wing corner flag for Odane Sinclair. Gets him with his back to play. He's very comfortable doing just that.
Well, you see his strength there along the boards as he holds defenders off. I mean, that's critical to the attack for the Ambush.
Nick Pollard back to his goalkeeper, Greg Crook for Chad Vandegrift. Corey Adamson loses at the center circle. And the Milwaukee Wave get it. They're simply contempt to play their goalkeeper, Nick Borberg. Adamson cuts that out. The bounce wasn't kind for Elvira Kavencic. Free kick for the visiting Milwaukee Wave. They're on top by a score of 5-3. The goals by Anthony Errico and Pablo. Marciolete. His pass cut up by Chris Mattingly. Mattingly for the Ambush. Tried to find Odin Sinclair in the left wing. Good composure there by number 18, the defender, Nick Pollard. Chris Mattingly now for the Ambush. Back to his goalkeeper.
Yeah, Milwaukee going in for the kill here. They've got a 2-goal lead. They're trying to just break the spirit of the Ambush by high pressure all over the field. A
lot of high pressure. Trying to get the ball back. If they lose it, they're trying to get it back as quickly as possible in as far advanced position as possible.
Wow, that would have been a good chance for the Ambush. Now they have it.
Elvira Kafedzic keeps it, rolls up at the sole of his shoe. This is number 18, Nick Pollard for the St. Louis Ambush. Knocks it sideways for Kafedzic, who comes back on the right point. Ball in towards the left wing corner flag for Odin Sinclair. Keeps it very nicely. They say he fouled Kirosh in the process, but Sinclair tries to scoop it over the defender's head, then the goalkeeper's head. Didn't quite work. There's going to be official stoppage of play as we look at that last defender in that collision with Sinclair.
He does hold, keep his arms out, shielding the ball, and he does throw the arms out. He might have caught the defender there.
Victor Kirosh down on the ground there. You see him, that number 23 shirt for the visiting Milwaukee Wave. Let's take a look at how the play developed again, Ty.
As usual, ball played in deep, and there's the muscle that he uses, but does he throw up the left arm a little bit? I don't know. I didn't see that much contact, but as tall and as strong as Sinclair is, as he goes to turn, almost naturally his arm comes up and may have caught the defender.
Second
there.
Hard tackle he's been involved in with a Milwaukee Wave player. This one, Victor Quiroz, he wears number 23.
Yeah.
Earlier with number 15, Tony Walls. They both seem to be okay. Walls came back almost immediately. Yeah, there's Kirosh. Here's yet another angle, Ty.
Well, here's the question. Is it an elbow or is it just a normal turning motion or something in between? Yeah, his arm comes around.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I think the forearm may have caught him. And that's just goes with the territory if you're going to try to muscle up with O'Dane Sinclair.
Uh-huh. You're going to pay the price usually. Yeah. Sinclair stands at 6'2", 205. He's from Kingston, Jamaica.
And he plays bigger.
Very much so. And you can feel comfortable playing the ball in on the ground to his feet. Yeah. Played for a former member of the St. Louis Steamers, Nate Hauser. Had 12 goals and 12 assists last year in his rookie of the year season for the St. Louis Ambush. Long ball for Axel Duarte to the aforementioned O'Dane Sinclair for Stephon St. Louis back on the field now for the St. Louis Ambush. Here's St. Louis, but a handball whistled up and a free kick for the Milwaukee Wave.
I have to say that the next goal is crucial.
Yeah, very much so.
In terms of the momentum and confidence and everything else for the Ambush. If they can get the next goal, this is a real game. They give up the next goal, you're afraid the heads drop.
Yeah, and you could be chasing the ball quite a bit because Milwaukee's very adept at just that.
They're pretty good at holding it, yep.
Nick Vorber, however, gives it away coming out of his backfield. This is Manny Forbes
nice
for
ball.
Schmerman. Stephon St. Louis. St. Louis in a dribble. Shot looking toward the near post boards, looking for the two goal scorer, Blake Ordell.
Ordell at that back post, poaching.
He was getting ready for a hat trick. This is Axel Duarte. Can he dig it out? He can't quite do so. Loses it to Bato. Bato comfortable with it, keeps it. Marcio Lete, likewise comfortable, knocks it back to keep it. Anthony Arrico. He scored the fourth of the evening. Shot by Arrico, saved by Greg Crook. However, Milwaukee keeps it. On the dribble. Across the goal mouth, trying to dig it out is number 15, Tony Walls. He's fouled in the process by O'Dane Sinclair, so it'll be a free kick for the visiting Milwaukee Wave.
Tony Walls. It was a clear foul.
Yes, no question.
The home fans booing, but it was a clear foul.
No question whatsoever.
No argument from Sinclair either.
You see the score line, the upper left-hand portion of your screen, 5-3 in favor of the Milwaukee Wave. 8:36 remaining in this, the third quarter. Four 15-minute quarters. We're at the St. Charles Family Arena. Home opener for the St. Louis Ambush in this 2014-15 season. Nick Vorberg for Tony Walls. Walls for the Wave. This is Marcelo Fontana. Drops back extremely deep for J.C. Banks. Banks on a dribble looking for Fontana, who started the play just a moment ago. Pablo couldn't get forward.
Yeah, Forbes, before the Ambush, tracked back well to make the defensive play there.
Still involved defensively. Kafejic, can either one of them dig it out? Yes, it's Manny Forbes, who's doing a ton of running. Draws a foul in the process just inside his center circle.
Forbes got clotheslined.
He did. Free kick now for the Ambush. Sinclair just content to keep it. Knocks it back for Richard Schmerman. This is Chad Vandegrift. To the goalkeeper, Greg Crook, well off his goal line. Eludes O'Dane Sinclair. Falls for Ross McGregor, but only temporarily, and he's fouled in the process by number 15, Tony Walls. Ambush keeps it on a free kick.
Sinclair getting involved for the Ambush at midfield and doing the up and back running. With his strengths, with his back to the goal, I wish he would just stay up closer to the Milwaukee goal.
Stay forward. Stay forward inside that penalty area so we have a target man to play the ball to.
Exactly.
Chad Vandegrift.
Nice.
Rolls with the sole of his shoe for Elvira Kafedzic. LSO. For number 15, Tony Walls to the goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. Out of the backfield again looking for LSO. This is Kafedzic. Elvira Kafedzic tries to get on the favorite right foot. Can't quite do so and loses control, but a dangerous play whistled up. So it'll be a free kick for the Wave coming out of their own half of the field with 7:20 remaining. 5-3, the Wave still on top of the Ambush.
I like Kafejic's confidence on the ball, his dribbling and his strength on the dribble, but if he's never going to go to his left foot, the defenders figure that out. He's rarely going to get a chance
exactly.
to get a shot on.
Uh-huh. And especially in a tight space like that, Ty. Nice early ball out of the backfield from Chan Vandervik for O'Dane Sinclair. Momentarily defending was Victor Quiroz. Good comfort level on the ball there from Nick Vorberg.
That's some good stuff by Milwaukee. Yeah.
Very nicely done out of their own backfield. They draw the foul in the process. Very comfortable on the ball, the Milwaukee Wave. That's the referee, Ron Corey, who whistled up for that foul.
Yeah, they're very fluid when they combine. Coming out of their own end, they know where the options are.
Yep, and that extra man is always available.
Yeah, and they're confident with that touch, too. Even in a tight space, they'll flick it. Know a guy could deal with it.
Uh-huh. On ball for Quiroz. Looking for Bata. Bata holds very nicely, waiting for a runner. But knocks it back to Jonathan Greenfield. Quiroz. Back for Jonathan Greenfield. Waves simply content to keep it. This is Bato, runs back, shows. They play it forward, they play it back to him, now into his feet. Was Marcelo Fontana on the attempted shot, Greg Crook.
Stefan St. Louis, pretty good defensive play there to clog up that one gap that started to appear.
Got back to help out defensively, did number 10, Stefan St. Louis. Now on the break of the shot from distance by number 26, Ian Bennett. That's a rare mistake from Bennett. He usually goes much forward, looks for the 1-2 or looks for the ball in behind people. Greg Crook rolls it to his captain, Chris Mattingly, with 6:01 remaining. Ambush down by a score of 5-3, over three lines.
Bill, we were talking about great left-footed players. We failed to mention Joe Reiniger.
When the three-point arc was in effect, he was always lethal.
We need him to come out and then maybe work with Kafedji
right now.
Left-footed strike, yeah.
Here's Marcio Lete for the Milwaukee Wave. Free kick for the Wave. They're simply content to keep it. And they do just that towards the right wing corner flag. There's Greenfield across the face. He started it, then Lete. They play the way they're facing back to their goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. Always the extra man available because he shows and makes himself available. LSO, back to Quiroz. Very nicely done on the heel pass. Wave get a shot and goal. Ooh, just wide of the near post. That should have been the sixth for the Wave by LSO. Defending at the last moment for the ambush there. He's down on the ground.
I think it's Manny Forbes.
That's Manny Forbes, yep.
Manny Forbes saved a goal, no question. He may have taken a knock to his head. I think he clearly did.
There's Lloyd Knudsen, the trainer for the St. Louis Ambush. Checking the health of number 20, Manny Forbes, with the Gordon College, Southern Wesleyan University. Let's see how that play developed, Ty.
Yeah, really good chance here for Milwaukee. This one here is about to be finished, and boy, he reaches back, Forbes does, and I think just got clipped in the back of his head by the heel of the Milwaukee Wave player.
And LSO certainly didn't mean to do that. Clip Manny Forbes, back in play. Crook rolls it for Nick Pollard. Pollard out of his own backfield, but cut up by Marcio Lete. Pollard again defending, looking for Blake Ordell. Rolls all the way back for Marcelo Fontana. Again, Milwaukee simply content to keep it. This is Marcio Lete, he's up forward now. The captain Mattingly for McGregor. Out of their backfield from Kafetsic to Ross McGregor. On the break is McGregor. McGregor with the shot. Saved by Nick Vorberg. Good goalkeeping from him and fouled by McGregor in the process. Good break nonetheless from the St. Louis Ambush as they got forward very nicely in the person of number 77, Ross McGregor.
That was a pretty good save by Vorberg.
Uh-huh.
Milwaukee goalkeeper.
Vorberg again with the ball at his feet. Long ball out of his own backfield. Headed back in by Richard Schmerman. This is Blake Ordell looking for his third, perhaps an ambush fourth. They trail by a score of 5-3 due to the ambush to the visiting Milwaukee Wave. They find the free man yet again. It's Anthony Errico, who has a goal of his own. Matter of fact, it was the fourth of the evening for the Wave. Now, this is Ross McGregor, who a moment ago got forward on the attack. There's a pushing foul, and we're going to see our first shootout. We're going to see our first shootout as Stefan St. Louis. He's followed by number 23, Victor Quiroz. And you mentioned, Ty, that he's been very, very active, not just coming back to help out defensively when he has to, but playing without the ball going to find the game.
Well, Stefan St. Louis, very confident on the dribble, too. Remember, he set up one of the goals in the first half of play with a very nice move to his right. And so see if he uses a similar move here to beat the goalkeeper.
Right, of Stefano Saint-Louis. Our first shootout of the 2014-2015 season. Let's see if number 10, Saint-Louis, can be effective. He had 8 goals, 7 assisting, 18 games played last year for the Missouri Comets. And yes, it's there. Very calm and composed by number 10, Stéphane Saint-Louis. Very nicely done from the 10 shirt.
Looks like TNT to me. That's dynamite. Confidence on the shootout. Stéphane Saint-Louis from Trinidad and Tobago. Or Tobago, is the exact one. A Soca Warrior.
Here it is again, Ty. Yeah. Very comfortable and calm is number 10, Stéphane Saint-Louis. And that's a real key in this indoor game. When I get the ball at my feet, in particular when I'm one-on-one with the goalkeeper, show some composure. He did that. He draws the ambush to within one. It's 5-4 now. 4:17 remaining in this, the third quarter.
Saint-Louis was also very accurate in the placement of the shot as well.
Wave trying to get more insurance now. This is Jonathan Greenfield at the left point, in deep to the left wing corner flag, looking for Ian Bennett. He's usually running at people as opposed to playing with his back to play.
This is a critical stage in the match.
Another ball in deep for Bato, looking for Ian Bennett. Good save by Greg Crook to cut out that near post. Good work from the goalkeeper, Greg Crook.
This is critical.
The
ambush have clawed their way back into it. They've got a real shot at changing the momentum here. They're playing at home. It's their home opener. And watch Milwaukee, though. They're going to try and nip it in the bud and go for a quick goal.
You said the next goal was going to be key, and that immediately put the ambush back into the game.
Let's see if they can capitalize now.
Milwaukee trying to get forward, coming out of their own backfield. They give it away. Chan Vandegrift doing the defending. This is Elvir Kafedzic. Missed the majority of last year, just about everything, with a knee surgery, ACL. This is O'Day and Sinclair. Tried to knock it across the face, did Manny Forbes on the heel pass. Breaks loose to Tony Walls, deep in his own end, defending, knocking it back to his goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. Victor Quiroz for number 20, Marcelo Fontana. Walkie wave getting forward nicely. Bato simply didn't see that ball coming across the goal mouth as it was toe poke. Here's Fontana again, but cleared by Kafedzic. Number 23, Quiroz. His shot blocked by Richard Sherman. Comes loose for LSO. This time on the right point is LSO. Luan Salas Oliveira across the goal mouth. Greg Crook gets a hand to it. Richard Sherman clears. This is O'Day and Sinclair.
And that was an important clearance.
Chasing back was Bato. Nick Forberg now for number 28, Jonathan Greenfield. Pace considerably picked up with 2:26 remaining. The Milwaukee Wave in possession. Anthony Arrico, he's got a goal so far this evening, the fourth of the evening for the visiting Wave. This is Marcio Leite coming in off the right flank. Axel Duarte defending. Milwaukee now doing just what you said they were going to do, Ty. Take the bit between their teeth and try to get on top by a two-goal margin again, looking for a sixth. It's 5-4, 2 minutes remaining in the third quarter. In favor of the visiting Milwaukee Wave at the St. Charles Family Arena. This is the home opener for the St. Louis Ambush. Jonathan Greenfield. Wave now again content to keep it. This is Stéphane Saint-Louis. Good job to dig this ball out. He's got Manny Forbes alongside. Good work from Stéphane Saint-Louis to keep it, and that was late. That was late, and a good call by the referee, Doug Wolf.
Tell you what, the ambush number 10 is fun to watch.
He is. He does everything, Ty. He gets back. He helps out defensively. Now he's egging on the crowd. Expect nothing less of a 10 shirt. Get involved in everything. Now a wonderful opportunity. Another shootout. Successful just a moment ago with Stéphane Saint-Louis.
Stéphane Saint-Louis, he's got composure, obviously, but he's got skills to back it up. He takes his time because he knows he has the abilities to take apart the opponent.
And this is Elvir Kafedzic. He wears number 9. Off the near post boards. The ball of the play is live. Cordy Adamson tried to rebound it at that opposite post. Inches off by Elvir Kafedzic.
A game of inches. Millimeters.
Right there is a clear example of just that. Nick Vorberg. Milwaukee can't quite get it out of their own end. Defending is Ross McGregor. It breaks loose for number 26, Ian Bennett. Good through ball on the ground and behind everyone. That has to be a foul, and it is. We'll see a shootout for the Milwaukee Wave.
Yeah.
That was number 15, Tony Walls getting forward. That last defender back fouling. There's the referee making the call. Ron Corey right on it. We just saw a shootout a moment ago from Elvira Kosecic. Hit the post and bounce forward. Corey Adamsman almost had it. Let's take a look at how that developed, Ty.
Yeah, the legs get tangled, but it's because he's behind him.
Yes.
It's a little bit of a clumsy challenge, and therefore a shootout resulting for Milwaukee.
This is the guy who scored the equalizing goal, the first goal for the Wave this evening. LSO, Luan Salas Oliveira. He'll be trying to put the ambush up. Excuse me, the Wave up by a score of 6-4. And he does just that. Very calmly, coolly, and efficiently does number 10, Luan Salas Oliveira. LSO, 6-4 now in favor of the visiting Wave.
Less than a minute to go in the third quarter. Ambush need to regroup here. They're well within striking distance and have played well enough to get a couple goals here.
They really have. They've done much better. But LSO, he put that to rest for just a moment. Another two-goal cushion for the visiting Wave, 6-4. Inside a minute remaining. Ambush waiting for the center off. They'll be here next Saturday night as well. Play against the defending champions in this league, the Chicago Mustangs. Yet another team in their central division. The Mustangs, the Wave, the Missouri Comets, the Tulsa Revolution, and the Wichita B-52s. There's Pablo. He's been very active for the Wave so far this evening. He gets forward as quickly as possible when they have a chance to take the break.
All right, so who's the mascot for the B-52s? Is it a rock lobster?
We're not certain yet. We're not certain yet. We don't know.
We had some great times at Wichita with the Steamers. I'll tell you what, those were some, as Gus Kyle would have said back in the real barn burners.
Barners, positively. Yeah. The Wichita Wings games against the St. Louis Steamers, either in Wichita or at the arena / Checker Dome. Referees talking this over. Deciding if Bato has yet to come out of the penalty box. It is Tim Boole talking it over with Doug Wolf, walking towards your camera right now. Under a minute left, as you can see, 6-4 in favor of the Milwaukee Wave. Stefan San Luis on the field, along with number 81, Blake Ordell. Chris Mattingly. Nick Pollard back defending.
Are they talking about putting some time back on the clock here? Not following what the controversy is.
Daryl fully cognizant of what's going on here, that it's very vital here in this under a minute scenario that the ambush certainly now not allow another goal.
Well, the ambush yard looks like they're going to be, what, each team with four aside?
Yes, sir.
Yep.
So Corey Dahl is off right now for the St. Louis ambush, as is Bato for the visiting Milwaukee Wave.
What, Gretzky loved these four against four, yeah. Did he? Or how about Derek Sanderson and Chuck Lefley?
Exactly, on a regular basis. There we look at Bato. He's in the penalty box for the visiting Milwaukee Wave. So 4-4. Arena soccer for a while. The ambush get it forward. This is the man who scored two goals so far this evening, Blake Ordell. The captain, Chris Mattingly. Nick Pollard for the ambush. Sends it long for the run of Mattingly. Mattingly still on the ball. Leaves it for Nick Pollard. Mattingly comes out towards the center circle, makes himself available. Blake Ordell with the shot from distance. Falls for Marcio Leyte. 17 seconds remaining in this, the third quarter. Ambush on top, excuse me, Wave on top by a score of 6-4. Jonathan Greenfield from Milwaukee. Simply just content to keep it, let it run out here in the third quarter. It's about to do just that, and it does just that. We conclude the third quarter, 6-4. 6-4, the visiting Milwaukee Wave on top. 1 15-minute quarter remaining in this match. So Blake Gardell, he has two goals from the ambush this evening. There's Joe Smigala and Daryl Duran talking it over as to what's going to transpire here with the four against four scenario. And in truth and actuality, the referee's still sorting this out. Doug Wolf, Tim Boole, the man in the box is Nemanja Pandjic.
With the Steamers, we always threw Jeff Cacciatore out there in the 4v4. It was like having two players.
Exactly. He was
so quick.
What a worker.
So quick side to side, too.
What a worker. And what a tie. What an absolute crowd pleaser Catch was.
Yep. He was so frustrating to play against training, at practice.
Nobody wanted any part of him.
Well, we would practice the power play, and he would be on the penalty killing unit. And, you know, you'd have to beat him three times.
Yeah.
You know, because he's right there in your face again.
And you mentioned a moment ago, Ty, about the rivalry between the old Wichita Wings and the St. Louis Steamers. And Jurgen Christensen, I remember in particular, who is this guy?
Get this guy away from me.
Continues to run.
It's like flypaper.
Yeah, you're not supposed to continue to run like that indoor.
Yeah. Yeah, you couldn't get rid of Catch. He was all over you.
So you talked about some of the areas in which the ambush has improved. What do you think the top one or two areas and where that improvement has taken place?
I'll start right at the back. I mean, Greg Crook has been outstanding tonight. I mean, not just the saves, he's made three or four outstanding saves, but the fact that he's so confident with the ball at his feet, the fact that he seems to be able to direct the defenders out in front of him, and perhaps most importantly, the confidence factor. They turn around and go, hey, he's got it covered, and they can play differently. They don't have to panic.
Exactly. They know they can knock it back to him.
Right. Now, the other things you like, obviously the addition of a player like number 10, Stephon St. Louis, you know, he's got flair, he's got strength, he's got dribbling ability. He's got the confidence to finish, and he does play with his head up. So this guy's fun to watch. And when you see O'Dane Sinclair, the rookie of the year in the league last year, has someone to play off of like St. Louis, you've got some things that you can build on for sure.
You really do.
Defensively, I think it's been more disciplined for sure. I think we've seen an ambush team that doesn't get rattled as easily, knows they're still in this game, and not in a panic mode like we saw too many times as an expansion team last year.
And one of the absolute keys, as you pointed out so accurately in the first quarter, Ty, is that it's just about imperative, almost mandatory, that you do indeed win these home games.
You got to make them count. There's only a 20-game regular season, and it's going to be really tough on the road. There's some good teams in the division.
We talked about that. Chicago Mustangs, they're here in town next Saturday night for a 7:35 matchup. Then the ambush goes away the following weekend to play the same team, the Chicago Mustangs. The Milwaukee Wave is back here on the 28th of November. Then the ambush sees the Milwaukee Wave again the first week in December. So you're getting a difficult opponent right away on two different occasions. The Wave three times and the Chicago Mustangs twice.
But Daryl Duran has some hardworking St. Louis guys, a goalkeeper from Columbia, Illinois. They're fighting, they're battling, and we've got this Caribbean flair now with Trinidad and Tobago, St. Louis, and O'Dane Sinclair from Jamaica. Yeah, they bring some special qualities, I think, to the ambush team.
I mentioned earlier, that's one of the first things that Daryl told me on Tuesday at training, is that I'm really looking forward to these two playing together. And Corey Adamson running from a little bit deeper position in midfield.
With a really good left foot.
Yeah, with a really good left foot. Yeah. He scored that first goal of the evening for the St. Louis ambush. Then LSO, Luan Salas-Olivera, he made it 1-1. And then now we are at 6-4 with 15 minutes remaining. This is the last quarter. We're on Gateway Television, the Gateway Television Network. I'm Bill McDermott. Alongside is Ty Keogh. And we'll be here all year for the home games for your St. Louis Ambush. This is their home opener at the St. Charles Family Arena, and this is the 2014-2015 season. That is the aforementioned Stephon Saint-Louis. Talking with his goalkeeper, likewise talking with Chad Vandegrift. They're still playing with four people. Likewise, the Milwaukee Wave. It's 4v4. Chad Vandegrift, far. Corey Adamson into the feet of Stephon Saint-Louis. Good initial touch from Saint-Louis. Losing a shoe in the process. Still pulls with the top of his shoeless foot. Very nicely done. Adding to the further add to the mystique. Saint-Louis will exit now. Along comes yet another new player, Manny Forbes. Now Milwaukee, they're back to full strength. Bato back on. Excuse me, they just make the change. Bato comes out of the penalty box, and they're back to five players now. Ambush still defending with four. The goalkeeper is Greg Crook. As Ty Keogh mentioned a moment ago, he's been superlative this season. Marcio Leyte with the shot. Good ball deep into the near post.
Another good stop.
Another good sure-handed save by Greg Crook. Covered that up very alertly and very quickly and did not give up a rebound. Tries to send it long, but Marcio Leyte cuts that out.
Even strength now.
Yep. 5v5. This is LSO, Luan Salas-Alaver. And Milwaukee's simply content to keep it now and have the Ambush run after them. I think they're taking a philosophy now, Ty Keogh, that the ball is not going to get tired. This is O'Dane Sinclair. He comes back to get involved in the game. Good work on the dribble, trying to get forward towards goal. He does just that, and he wins a foul in the process. That's nothing but absolute determined hard work and skill and physical ability.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's a pretty good footwork. It's a pretty good skill there in a tight space and holding off defenders.
In the open field, too, Ty, very difficult. Yep. So Chad Vandegrift behind this now on the ground for number 23, Axel Duarte. Yet another new player for the St. Louis Ambush. Be careful now here on the break. It's Luan Salas-Alaver. He likes to be called LSL. Told us to call him that. We'll do just that. They try to get it out quickly to him, couldn't quite do so. Now the Ambush in possession on this free kick deep in their own end. Greg Crook, it's been strong all evening in departments like this. Long flighted balls are balls at people's feet. That was very comfortably done by JC Banks as he headed it back to his goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. Milwaukee now content to keep it with more pressure now by the Ambush. Elvira Kafedzic. Try to help out. It's LSO on the run. Good ball across the face by number 26, Ian Bennett. Another superlative save by Greg Crook. This is Ian Bennett on the right wing back for number 15, Tony Walls. No relation to Nick Walls, the former player from St. Louis University, who likewise was from Milwaukee. Everyone wondered that here in St. Louis, but there is indeed no relation. Number 12, Pablo. He's comfortable here, either deep or getting forward. And as you can see, just momentarily, they're very comfortable on the ball. Long ball out of his own end from the goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. Looking for Richard Schmerman, and he's fouled in the process.
He had an autograph that jersey for him. He handed it over to him.
He went to trade shirts during the game. 12:06 remaining. The Ambush trailing by a score of 6-4. The Milwaukee Wave.
A lot of pressure by Milwaukee.
And yes, there's a seventh. There's a seventh for the visitors. Tenzin Rampa, who's been up, back. Very industrious player for the Milwaukee Wave. Number two, Tenzin Rampa.
The Ambush, just a bit too casual. Deep in their own end here. Gets turned over. Nice little heel pass, really, to set the table. That one hurts. Three goals gets tough. The clock starts to become an ally of the Milwaukee Wave.
It really does. Now with 11:54 remaining. Tenzin Rampa with the seventh for the visitors. Very nicely engineered. They were very patient. They cut the ball out when they had to, give it to the open player, and he monopolized. Ooh, Stefan Saint-Louis on the turn was thinking about the side volley.
He thought about it. I would love to see him try it.
There's Ross McGregor getting forward.
And Ambush temporarily stretched out there, but yeah, looks like they have pulled it back together.
Marcelo Fontana doing the work. There's Esquiros. Lete. Bato. The goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. 11:08 remaining. And you can see that Milwaukee Taikyo has been in this situation many times. They're very comfortable when they have a lead of any kind, especially away from home with a 3-goal lead.
Yeah, they're an experienced, established team, and they've shown it. What I want to see from the Ambush, I think this is important here. They may not be able to pull back from a 3-goal deficit, but do they fight to the very end? I think that ends up telling you maybe what kind of season this is going to be. Just what they do here in the last 10 minutes. What kind of spirit does this team have? Yeah. What kind of drive does
it
have?
What do you show in your home opener?
This even if it's a losing effort.
Exactly.
But do you play with the grit that you need to be successful in this league?
This is Nick Vorberg, the goalkeeper for the Milwaukee Wave. Anthony Arrico, he has one this evening. Quiros plays it to the feet of his keeper. This is Marcio Leite at right point, in towards the right wing corner flag. Pretenzen Rampa, who just scored the seventh for the Wave. 10:05 remaining. Slight collision there. Odeon Sinclair, he gets the worst of it. Draws the foul in the process. This will be a free kick for the Ambush. Just under 10 minutes remaining. That was Marcio Leite who committed that last foul. That's Tenzin Rampa.
Well, you know, Odeon Sinclair, he dishes that out quite a bit, but when he can take it,
oh, too. Positively.
He got right back
he just
up.
Did right there. Chad Vandegrift, good ball on the ground for the aforementioned Odeon Sinclair. Couldn't quite get to it. Couldn't turn his body. Nick Vorberg. Stellar, as always, in goal for the Milwaukee Wave.
And Bill, Daryl Duran mentioned to you, Jeff DiMaria possibly a signing for after the first of the year.
Possibly. Yeah. Still working maybe on that.
I'd like to see that. Just one more experienced player, a two-way player.
And a nonstop worker in the midfield area.
Yeah. I mean, Jeff we talked about Jeff Cacciatore. There's Jeff DiMaria.
Yeah. Started his college soccer career at the University of Connecticut and varsity for St. Louis University. Came back for his last 2 years. Mm-hmm. Free kick again for the St. Louis Ambush. This is Axel Duarte, one of the five defenders being utilized this evening for Daryl Duran, Richard Schmerman. Manny Forbes on the dribble. Couldn't quite get forward. Lost it in the process.
Losing his composure.
Was upset by the call by the referee. Ron Corey there. New player, wants to please. Jonathan Greenfield for the Ambush. He'll probably just knock it back to his goalkeeper. He does just that. Very rare error from Nick Vorberg coming out of his own goal area.
Wow, that would have been a gift to really punish them back.
Manny Forbes for Kafedzic. Working the 1-2, Odeon Sinclair. This is Axel Duarte. Elvira Kafedzic with his left tie. That's what you said you wanted to see. He struck the ball nicely.
It was a decent shot. I didn't know he would even decide to make that move to his left, but he did.
And the visiting Milwaukee Wave say to the referee, Ron Corey. Goalkeeper does, Nick Vorber. We're taking the timeout with 8:33 remaining. Simply talking about what they're going to do to protect this 3-goal lead. And there is Daryl Duran saying, what are we going to do in this home opener to get back into this game immediately?
All right, at least create some excitement here in the closing minutes. Uh-huh. Make it close. Mm-hmm. Give the fans what they've come for, a real battle.
Number 81 is Blake Gardell. Stefan Saint-Louis, we've talked a lot about him. He wears number 10. Corey Adamson's number 4. Three of the real mainstays, at least so far this evening, for the St. Louis Ambush.
Well, they've had a lot to do with the attacking play and goal scoring.
Yeah, very much
Cordell, so. 2 goals. Mm-hmm. Stefan Saint-Louis set up the first one for Cordell.
Got the fourth for
got
the Ambush.
On the shootout, that's right.
And he showed some real composure on that particular play. That's Doug Wolf facing the camera. With his back to the camera is Ron Corey, two of the referees assigned this evening. Tim Boole the other. There's the new coach for the Milwaukee Wave. Begging with this team, really telling them, let's keep this three-goal lead.
Just focus.
And in the process,
focus is a big part.
Use
of it.
Your composure.
Finish it off.
Keep the possession.
Now, here's the difference. You've seen this Ambush team tonight play with a lot of intensity. They've really fought for each other, which is fantastic, and I think the fans appreciate it. I do. But you watch a Milwaukee team collectively. They seem to have just a better idea of what their teammates are
doing.
They move as more of a unit. You know, that it's not a huge contrast, but you can see that this Milwaukee team has been together for several seasons, and they know how to play to each other's strengths.
The experience really shows, Ty, and sometimes it seems like they're using six field players.
Yeah, they got an extra option.
There's always somebody available. Shot taken by number
good 28, stop
Jonathan Greenfield, that was headed for the opposite side netting. Another good save by Greg Crook. Ian Bennett.
I keep wanting to say Crook robbed him.
Yeah. Tight defending. Wonderful shot by our crew here on the Gateway Television Network. That's field level. That's what the goalkeeper is seeing right now as the play comes toward him. So it's LSO back to his goalkeeper, Nick Vorberg. He returns the favor. Marcelo Fontana.
Milwaukee has some set plays that they use during the run of play that are coordinated, especially when they go back to Vorberg, the goalkeeper.
He looks long if it's on.
Right.
If it's not long on to send it through the air, he puts it on the ground on the protected side.
Yeah.
Here's Stefan Saint-Louis back helping defensively. Greg Crook dives at the feet. That last offensive player, always dangerous for a goalkeeper. Whoa, what a tackle
there
from Stefan Saint-Louis. In the open field, however, he loses it to number 23, Victor Quiros. Quiros with the shot. Hits where the crossbar meets the post. What a blast for number 23, Victor Quiros.
That was a crunching tackle, though, a moment ago.
Stefan Saint-Louis.
Bodies are flying.
There is Greg Crook, who you talked about from Columbia, Illinois. Let's watch how this develops. That's at the near post, Greg Crook again.
Yeah, that's a courageous. There's the muscle there, Saint-Louis. Yeah, you got a little too careless, I think, there at midfield.
Greg Crook looking for Ross McGregor. Couldn't quite control the ball. Was number 77, Ross McGregor, yet another new player for the St. Louis Ambush. There are 10 new players for the Ambush this year. New league, new players, and perhaps a new attitude. And as Ty Keogh just mentioned, the home fans want to see some of that late in this fourth quarter. 6:44 remaining. Will the experience of the Milwaukee Wave continue to be troublesome for the St. Louis Ambush? This is Marcio Leyte, a good burst late in the game. Taken away defending as Ross McGregor for the St. Louis Ambush. Keeps the ball very nicely done. Kofedzic trying to send number 5, Corey Dahl, forward. And Milwaukee can keep it at pace as well, tie in a tight position.
Yeah, they're well coordinated.
They really are.
They really, and they show confidence in their teammates because they spread the ball around.
Anybody can handle it anywhere. This is Bennett now. Forward, back, forward from Leyte. Breaks loose for Kofedzic. Will Kofedzic get a shot on goal? Keeps it. Looks to change it to the opposite side of the field. Finds Axel Duarte. The captain, Chris Mattingly.
The off-the-ball running by Milwaukee. It's been a pretty good lesson, I think.
Stefan Saint-Louis! Off the crossbar. Good work from Saint-Louis yet again. Mattingly for Duarte. In on the ground, looking for Odane Sinclair. Finds him on a side volley. It's Sinclair just above the crossbar. Manny Forbes digs it out for the Ambush. At least attempts to do so. Can't quite get the handle as Manny Forbes. Nick Vorberg clears it, but only momentarily. Forbes again! Nick Vorberg comes out at the near post.
Good pressure, though. Excellent pressure by the Ambush. High energy and forcing some mistakes for once by Milwaukee deep in their own end.
Good work by Manny Forbes there to keep the ball alive. And the Ambush now with 5:18 remaining, 7-4. They trail. Daryl Duran wants to call a timeout and talk about it. What do you think he's talking about, Ty?
Well, I think he wants to keep the intensity, obviously. I think he likes what he just saw there in the last 15, 30 seconds where the ambush, it did pay off for them, the high pressure with some turnovers deep in Milwaukee's end. They got to do more of that and make it count, though.
Daryl talking her with Axel Duarte. He wears number 23, new player. Number 10, Stephon Saint-Louis, new player. Number 20, Manny Forbes, new player. And that's pretty much been our theme so far this evening, not just the new league and new division, quite a few teams around the country.
Added some talent.
Had some real talent.
And guys that worth watching, fun to watch.
The Ambush will return here next Saturday night. Next Saturday night here to the St. Charles Family Arena. They'll be taking on the Chicago Mustangs. 7:35 is game time. And the Ambush now bring on that sixth attacker tie.
Yep.
To that I say, why not?
Yeah. That was close.
That's Chris Mattingly, the sixth attacker, and he will immediately get back into the flow of things
now. He's under pressure.
Oof. Almost lost it to Marcelo Fontana. Marcio Leite, can he get forward? He tries to dig the ball out away from Corey Dowell. Here's a long shot. Yes, it's there. Yes, it's there from number 20, Marcelo Fontana, the oldest player in the field by a goodly margin, 41 years of age.
Tell you what, that was well measured. That's not that easy to do. I know the net's empty, but he had to make the decision quickly. This ball's loose.
He digs it out.
Look, immediate reaction here. I know what I'm going to do. It was more his anticipation, his foresight, than anything else. And a perfectly placed ball. And now, without a three-point goal any longer.
Yeah. You really have to do some work.
Now that, I think that iced the game, but let's see if they can make it close.
So Marcelo Fontana with the eighth of the evening for the visiting wave, 4:50 remaining. Chris Mattingly still on as that sixth player on the field, the extra attacker. It's Mattingly now. They're trying to get the ball in deep to Stephon Saint-Louis. There's Corey Adamson back for Mattingly. It's got to be on goal! And there it was, Nick Vorberg. Good shot from the added attacker, Chris Mattingly. That goes
Mattingly
long out of play.
He got all of that
ball.
Yes,
he did.
That was moving.
That was right on goal. Nick Vorberg made no pretense trying to save that. He'll be punched it clear. Now it's O'Day Sinclair from a deeper position. He's at the top of the point, looking for Mattingly with six players on the field.
I think they called a handball.
They did indeed. Referee Doug Wolf whistled up there. 4:15 left, 8:14.
With the loss of possession, Crook is back in goal for the Ambush.
Getting back into goal, there's a tied shot of Ray Crook back into goal for the St. Louis Ambush. In Milwaukee, they've been doing it all night long. They'll simply be content to keep the ball. Let's see if they can keep it as well as they do, this time with much more pressure from the Ambush. And they win it because of that Ambush. It's Elvira Kafedzic. Wherever he loses it to number 12, Pablo.
Crook is trying to get off again for the sixth attacker.
Milwaukee in possession now, yep.
Right, Ambush gave up possession though.
Marcio Leite. Jonathan Greenfield. Fontana.
Going to go for 20 passes here.
They're simply just going to keep it. They're on the road. They're winning by 4:03 left. Jonathan Greenfield, the captain for the visiting Milwaukee Wave. Axel Duarte defends. It falls to the feet of O'Day Sinclair. He's got Ross McGregor. Still in possession is O'Day Sinclair. Can he dig this out? Yes, he does. Gets a shot. Just wide of the near post. Magnificent work from O'Day Sinclair.
What an effort. I would have loved to have seen him get rewarded for it. He did not quit on that ball.
He did not. Axel Duarte now finds Chris Mattingly, who's back on as that sixth attacker for the St. Louis Ambush with 2:55 remaining. They trail by a score of 8-4. What a blast from Stephon Saint-Louis, trying to get a fifth for the Ambush. Long ball trying to come out of their own end from number 20, Marcelo Fontana. A rare giveaway by the way as they try to get forward.
Well, that ball off the post. Remember the shootout off the post by Kafedzic.
Chad Vandegrift.
That's how close it could have really been, a very tight match if those go in.
Manny Forge now for Schmierman, looking for Elvira Kafedzic. Chad Vandegrift cuts it out defensively. This is Tenzin Rampa. He scored the sixth goal of the evening for the visiting Milwaukee Wave. And they remain on top by a score of 8-4 due to the Milwaukee Wave. This is Chris Mattingly, Manny Forbes, yet a new player in the starting lineup for the St. Louis Ambush. Back to the goalkeeper with the yellow shirt on now, designated the sixth attacker, Chris Mattingly. Falls for Chad Vandegrift. Ambush have to keep it here to make something happen. In deep, Blake Ardell almost got in the end of that. Manny Forbes, who continues to work for Kofedzic. Just past the opposite post for number 9, Elvira Kofedzic. Marcelo Fontana tried to clear, but it falls directly to the feet of Elvira Kofedzic. Back for Manny Forbes. And coming out of his own backfield is Tony Walls, then Anthony Errico. Ian Bennett continues to work, as does J.C. Banks. Everyone for the Milwaukee Wave. Everybody's on deck for this last 1:27 for the Milwaukee Wave. Greenfield back to defend. Kidosh, he sends the ball out. For number 26, Ian Bennett. And that's an intentional foul.
Yep.
And just a free kick going to be whistled up by Doug Wolf for the pulling of the shirt there. Wave on top by a score of 8-4 with 1:18 remaining. I think the result of this game is pretty much beyond question right now.
Let's see the Ambush get one, at least send them home smiling on the final goal.
If there's a last goal to be scored this evening, let's see it be scored by the St. Louis Ambush to get some work for all this effort. Greg Crook back on now for Chad Vandegrift. Greg Crook for Richard Schmerman. Schmerman for Stefan Saint-Louis. Inside a minute, 55 seconds remaining. Stefan Saint-Louis. His shot goes wide and high beyond the plexiglass. Milwaukee in possession now. As I mentioned, the Ambush comes back here. Back to the same venue, the St. Charles Family Arena. Next Saturday night against the Chicago Mustangs. Game time, 7:35. Nick Pollard defending. Trying to create something here in the last 40 seconds. Milwaukee still in possession. It's Bato. Bato for the Wave, leaves it for Kiros. Let's just keep it now. Send it long if we have to, like that. This is number 77, Marcio Leite. He's been active all night long. Ian Bennett. Good defending from that last defender, Nick Pollard. Elvira Kofedzic on the dribble, coming in off the left flank. On the dribble, it's Kofedzic. 7 seconds left. Kofedzic, it falls to Greg Crook. Have a go yourself, Greg, and he does just that. Greg Crook and saved by the opposite goalkeeper, Nip Forberg. And that was entertaining in the very last as the goalkeeper gets a blast off Greg Crook. But unfortunately, with all the effort, Ty, again, it's the same old story against this difficult team to beat, the Milwaukee Wave, with the final 8-4 in favor of the visitors.
There are some positives here. I think there are some quality players that have been added to the roster. I think it's a team that did show more composure than many times the Ambush did last season. This would have been probably double digits goals against the Ambush last year.
Without any question.
They didn't panic. They were down by a couple goals. They didn't panic. They kept it close as long as they could. And they came up against a quality Milwaukee team that is well organized and very experienced and has been together for several seasons.
And you see that experience firsthand with the main ingredient when I asked Daryl Duran, what's the key to indoor soccer? Possession. They do indeed have that main ingredient mastered. So 6,609 saw this home opener for the St. Louis Ambush. The final score was 8-4 in favor of the visiting Milwaukee Wave. For Ty Keogh, I'm Bill McDermott. It's been our pleasure to be with you here this evening on the Gateway Television Network. We'll be with you again next Saturday night as the Chicago Mustangs come to town. Again, the final 8-4 in favor of the visiting Milwaukee Wave. Good night, everybody, from St. Charles.
Right, fire, goal! That's goal!